Shoot.
I'll start with an easy one.
Sure.
Closed-ended one. Where did the idea for the plastic feet come from on the titles? I think that's
cute, clear feet, because I like them. Yeah, I there are a lot of little details that go back to like my childhood and stuff. When I was young, I grew up, you know, pretty poor. I liked to tinker and stuff, but I really couldn't buy stuff, so I would you know, junk a lot of stuff that I'd get at yard sales and stuff. But one of the things they always had at the Radio Shack or something was these little clear feet. And I used to put them on everything I built, just because I just loved them. So yeah, it's a you know, personal thing. Yeah.
As someone who obviously, you know, had your sort of your early start in years in visual visual art, what about that? What about that has been most influential into your business ventures, your friends, and other things now into your later years of more prolific years of
the visual. Well, it's a lot. I mean, I'm a very visual person. I have a very visual mind, like a three-dimensional visual mind, which is why I do a lot of mechanical stuff and reverse engineering stuff. I think in three dimensions, and I think visually. So the graphic arts, it's just been something I've always done. I mean, even from my earliest years, I was always sketching and doing you know, doing artwork and stuff. So the aesthetic and style aspect for the stuff that I do, a lot is rooted in the visual. Like those illuminated titles you saw I did in the early 90s, I'm still doing stuff like in that kind of motif in my artwork and stuff, so there's going to be a new Frantone t-shirt that's almost just like that. So yeah, it's a fundamental root in what I do. Anyone else? Question?
Even with the no free time thing, are you still continuing sort of artistic hobbyist pursuits?
Well, at this point in my life, everything is work. So I look at everything as work. If I'm painting, it's still work. I figure someday I'll sell it, you know.
Yeah.
so it's all work, yeah. Always on the clock. That's the thing is you're, after a certain number of years, you're never off the clock. Even if you find that you've got like a day, like a week off, that never happens, but even a week off, I would just instantly just start to work on the next thing. It's just, it becomes a part of who you are, just work.
As you know, through your experiences, do you find that most people who have been successful in similar situations would have that kind of drive and insanity?
Yeah. Yeah, it's something, well, part of one of those things I say, you know, relationships and friendships. When you get to a certain point in a career, and you know, my good friend Chris Butler, he was the guitar player and songwriter and the Waitresses and stuff. But he told me many times, as you know, when you reach a point in a career, you get to the point where, you know, you're in the solitude of high achievement, you know, where just because of the kind of world you build around you to do what you do, it isolates you. And so the only people you really associate are people who are similarly isolated and similarly crazy. And I found, you know, as far as like friendships and stuff, people work 9-to-5 jobs and have regular careers, they simply cannot understand like someone like myself. There's just nothing that I could ever talk about that they could relate to. So it's just a conversation killer. Oh, what do you do? 45 minutes later, I'm talking to the wall, you know. So, yeah. So it's, you know, and even among musicians, musicians that work, they suffer the same way. You know, they end up in a band and they don't have, you know, there's no friends. It's just the band and the tour, that's their life, you know, and everything else just falls apart. So it's...
What was the crazy
solitude? High achievement. Yeah. Yeah, it's like, you know, well, my dad had an analogy that he used to use. He said, life is the beach. This is what my dad used to say. He said, life is the beach. So imagine everybody in the world, they're on the beach, right? You decide that you're going to go out in the water. Well, a lot of people go out in the water. You know, they'll go out, you know, ankle deep, knee deep, you know, everyone's flat, you know, in the water. But you go out, you know, head deep. Well, how many people are out there with you head deep? You know, probably like maybe a few people here and there, you know. Well, you swim out where you're not touching, your feet aren't touching the bottom anymore. Now you're the only one out there. You're all alone. And you're looking back at the beach where everyone is there on the beach and they're staring at you like you're some kind of crazy person. And that's what achievement is like. When you get your life ahead where you're just doing things, you're following your own path, you get apart from the crowd. And when you get out there, you're going to find that it's a lonely place.
I've got, like, I guess two kind of related questions.
Sure.
That are somewhat about, like, adversity in this business. As somebody who, like, I guess, say, you build original designs,
right.
Do you find it frustrating that a lot of the people that have kind of jumped on this boutique pedal train in the past 10 years are, like, just cranking out, you know, tube screamer clones with resistors that are chained?
Yeah.
And also building off of that, like, I think the way that I found out about you was through, like, the very close-knit and incestuous community of effects pedal forums. And, you know, the amount of shit I've seen slung at female pedal builders like Steph or Cattle Bread or Debbie Ever is just, like, absolutely sickening. And I was wondering whether you think that your experience in this industry, which I guess you could say is decidedly a boys' club, has been any different.
No.
No?
No. No, it's, but, you know, it's not, it's the same as anywhere in STEM, you know, women in STEM, it's a small club, but, you know, we all complain about it. But I point the finger, well, it's easy to point the finger at bigotry, but I also point the finger at women for not participating. You know, I had this forum, where we were on a panel just earlier in the year at UPenn, and you know, I criticize women for not being a part of the pedal community. Not, you know, and there are more and more guitar players, but still, women who actually do engineering or do tech or actually do building, it's just so few. So the bigotry happens from the ubiquitousness of the crowd. So the more homogenized a crowd is, the more prejudicial the crowd gets to anyone who doesn't follow into their model. And that's true of everything. So it doesn't matter what the crowd is, it doesn't matter, you know, race, gender, all these things are just variables you can plug into that bigotry. But the more ubiquitous and more homogenized any crowd is, the more and more it is prejudicial to anyone or anything that is not part of that form. And the pedal community is it definitely is a decidedly one kind of character. Forums, I mean, I think, you know, when I announced the Kickstarter for the Peach Fuzz, a fan put up a post on a forum that I was doing a Kickstarter to bring back the Peach Fuzz, and quite literally the second comment in the thread is, fuck Frantone and fuck Fran and fuck Kickstarter, and then it just went from there. And that's pretty much it. So, but no, I try to do my thing outside of, I've always done it outside the establishment. Never was a part of NAMM, never did the NAMM shows, never did that crowd. I try to find ways to do the handshake, that thing I'm talking about, the handshake, to make the handshake happen outside of the really entrenched structure of the business. And the music merch business is, it's a harsh place. I've been in it a long time, you know, and it's just, it's very hard. There's a lot of anger, kind of, you know, because it's basically, you know, frustrated musicians, you know, so pent up anger and stuff. So there's different psychological levels to it. But I basically try to avoid it. I never argue. I never start fights. I don't participate in fights. If people are being mean to me on a forum, I just don't participate in it. I just let them vent. And so I just kind of go around the whole thing, try to make a great product, and then try to find creative ways to bring those people who would want the product to my product, to bring it in without having to participate in all the nastiness.
Yeah.
So
I know other pedal builders that don't exercise that reserve. Almost never looks good for them.
Yeah, I mean, but there are some people who like the drama of it.
Yeah.
But that's true in, part of entrepreneurship is that whole drive thing, and there are some entrepreneurs, and I've known many over decades, who are, they just like to fight, you know, so, but I'm not that kind of person. You know, I would just rather engineer and save my energy for the work, so.
Yeah.
Yes.
Do you think there's like, is it harder to get into like the pedal industry in like today's world than you did, because like there's not as many newer innovative ideas now, or is like, do you think there are still like room to make like pedals that have never been made, or like sounds that have never really been heard before?
Yeah, that's a good question. It is criticized as being a saturated market, and that's probably understating it. I mean, 10 years after I started Frantone, it was a saturated market, because I'd gone from maybe having like 3 competitors to having dozens. You know, by the time I built my factory in Brooklyn in 2002-2003, there were dozens and dozens of companies. Now there are quite literally hundreds of companies. And like you said, a lot of them are doing disbanding, you know, doing bends or clones and stuff. In the analog realm, the idea of coming up with new things, it's not that you can't do it, but I kind of reserve my designs I sell to things that would be sellable. So yeah, I can make some very strange things that maybe hadn't been done before, but I learned from the glacier that those things are really impossible to market. If you're doing something really out there that someone can't just plug in and play a solo and, you know, and finish a record, you're not gonna sell many of them. They might get written up a lot, and like the glacier did, it got in a lot of magazines, but people didn't buy them. It's like, just too weird. So you kind of have to have this balance of, well, if you want to make money, you got to make things that people will use. And so you kind of make things that are useful. And it can get hard to be unique and useful in a completely saturated market. But that's where the creativity comes in. You know, the design aesthetic, the interface with it, you know, there are subtle things that you point out in the product. You know, it's more of a game of millimeters rather than yards. Yes. Okay. Okay. No, go ahead.
Essentially, this is somewhat related to that, since you do restoration and reverse engineering, especially of rare, stranger things, specific transistors, match pairs, ICs, that have become extinct and are harder and harder to find. How do you necessarily deal with that when that happens?
Yeah.
It's
a challenge. Extinct parts, there's no trick to it. I have the benefit of having just a lot of parts that are extinct. You know, I don't have as many as I used to, because one of the adversities is you lose property. And when I had to downsize tremendously when I moved from Brooklyn to PA, I moved into a 6,000 square foot building that I absolutely filled with parts. And when I moved out of that building, I downsized to 1/6 the size, and I had to purge tons of parts. I had to give them away. I didn't want to put them in the dumpster, so I was just giving away boxes and boxes and boxes of like 50-year-old parts. Broke my heart. But I still have like a good number of parts. And so pretty much, if you're doing something retro, we're using antiquated parts, it's pretty much what you have on hand, or if you come into a stockpile of something, it might be something that no one's really using at the time, and you might find a way, well, maybe there's a way I can, if I got 1,000 of these transistors, maybe I can build something with that. And when the run is done, the product is done. It's just that simple. But the search for antiquated, because there are certain parts that get lauded, you know, certain numbers that come like golden, like was a 4558D or something. Now it's like 20 years ago, if you could imagine that a 4558 would sell for dollars, it just would have blown your mind. So certain parts get a reputation just because it's in this kind of gear, you know, and people want to do a copy of that, so you need that thing. But it, you know, those kinds of details. This is one thing, conversation I had with Dave Jones at the EEV blog, about how ridiculous the mojo around certain parts is. Because you can engineer something to use a lauded part, using something completely different that performs exactly the same way. And you could A/B them, give, you know, let people hear them, and people wouldn't be able to tell the difference just because you're engineering pedal that responds the same way. So if it's parts dependent, like if a part is critical, it can't be reproduced, then the product just ends, or you can't make the product. But the other option is to re-engineer it to have the same performance characteristics, to, have, to perform the same way sonically, have the same sound, have the same response, using completely different design. That's what I did with the Big Muff. So.
How do you structure a business, like the peach fuzz that I have, that thing will probably never die.
Probably.
You know, I bought that in like 2005 or 2006 when I was like 12 years old.
Wow.
And I've had it since then, and it's like never had so much of a hiccup, you know? Like, how do you create a business model around something that's going to last 10 or 20 years or more?
Yeah.
You know, like, I mean, I would like to buy another Frantone pedal in the future, but it would probably be a long time before I have another $200 or $300 to spend on a boutique, you know, overdrive pedal. Is that a challenge in doing what you do, as opposed to making something disposable?
Yeah.
Impulse
buying? Well, the longevity of the product became a problem because, you know, one of my founding rules is that I wanted to make a gear for professionals, professional musicians. And I was making gear to withstand the kinds of rigors that I would expect a piece of gear to withstand, meaning that you build a pedal so that it can be kicked around, thrown at the wall, knocked around in tour cases, thrown on the cement, you know, dragged around every day and not fail. Well, I did that. So I got pedals that have been out there for 20 years and they haven't failed. And so you're not replacing products, so it's easy to saturate a market. And I did that early on. I think by the time you bought that pedal, I was probably a lot of my customers were all full up with Frantone, and so I think I would get a lot of calls. Well, my pedal was stolen, or gear was stolen, or my friend took my pedal and won't give it back, you know, stuff like that. But yeah, the longevity of the pedal, the living, undead quality of it. It gets to be a challenge from a marketing standpoint. If you're selling to the same people, like you say, you know, people are collecting pedals. But part of that solution is, again, diversification. So when I was a two-pedal company, I saturated the market pretty quickly. I mean, in the 90s, there just weren't that many people who were going to buy a boutique pedal. And pretty much all those people bought Frantone by 2001, too. So when I brought it back in Brooklyn, I knew that the model would have to be that, well, I have to come out with new designs at certain, you know, at least every quarter, come out with something new so that I can sell something different, even to the same person, or maybe someone didn't want a peach fuzz, maybe they wanted a compression pedal and I didn't make that, so I could make that. So diversifying the line, expanding the line, is part of the key in a model where, in a business where you're not replacing the same thing. Make something else.
Building off of that, have you given any thought to reissuing the optical compressor?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I would like to. I'm very proud of the sandwich. It was. In my view, it's my favorite pedal, because the compressors, I designed those from scratch. They weren't based on any existing design. I had to invent my own optocoupler to get the response. Yeah, I built those in-house, so they're all proprietary. But I had to build the optocouplers from scratch. About 6 months, really, of refining those designs. But the other thing about the sandwich is that it's the only it's a three-knob compressor. But one of the things about compressors is, as you increase the compression, the volume just goes up. So you usually have to have four knobs. You turn up the pre and you turn down the post. But the sandwich was designed so that one knob, as you turn up the compression, the output volume remains constant. And it's all done in analog. So, no, it is a really pretty design. I mean, yes, I'm very, very pleased with it. But I love the optical press. I actually use them at home because I was in radio. I sort of ended up with a fetish for FM radio compression. So when I hear music, especially if I'm going off the MP3 or whatever, I need to have that heavy bottom FM compression. So I actually use my sandwich to compress the MP3 audio so I can get the FM compression. So, yeah.
Pretty much other
Yeah, I guess.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming. Thanks. I appreciate it. Thanks.